All right, now it's our turn. Let's stand and sing Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 through 8. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. I will confirm my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers. Abram fell face down, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham. For I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. The whole land of Canaan, where you are now an alien, I will give as an everlasting possession to you and your descendants after you, and I will be their God. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this day you've blessed us with. We thank you for this pretty spring morning. Pray that you'll continue to bless our church, and thank you for all you've done all these years. to keep our church going so strong. Thank you for all who have come out today for this service. Bless them, O Lord, and be with Pastor Keith as he brings the message this morning, and bless all who are here today, and thank you for all you've done for us. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Would you stand with me as we continue singing this morning? I was remembering the story when Jesus feeds the 5,000 and the little boy comes forward and he's got his loaves and his fishes and it's kind of just enough for him. That story reminds me of a line in this next song called Gratitude, and it just talks about giving God your heart, because really that's all we have to give him in the grand scheme of things. The song goes, I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah. Would you sing this song with me this morning? All my words
so get up and morning. Welcome to Faith Church. Let's take our Bibles and turn to Genesis chapter 17, and we'll open up in a word of prayer. Father, thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for the privilege to meet together as a body of believers. Lord God, I just pray that you would use your word. That's why we're here. We're here to sing about you, to worship you, and to allow you to work in our lives. And so, Father God, that's what I pray today, that you would honor your word, that you would be at work in our service. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You can do the video now. If it's going to be an issue, that's fine. All right, that's good, guys. Let's go to Genesis chapter 17. And it's a creation video. It's just something I found. And we can skip it. 10 years ago, we didn't use videos in church. But thinking about God's creation, the foundation for everything that we believe about God, the world, our lives, life and death, eternity, good and evil, goes back to the beginning, to creation. The first words in the Bible are not just the first words chronologically. They're really the first words of importance. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. These words established the fact that it was God who created all of the universe, the galaxies, the stars, the planets, our own sun and earth and moon. God created and designed the atoms, the molecules, the cells. God created and designed the laws of nature, the laws of physics, and the laws of biology. Knowing that God is the creator of all heaven and earth establishes a little about our understanding of him, actually a lot of our understanding of him. As creator, God is eternal. He existed before time, before anything that is now in existence. As creator, God is all-knowing. He was able to create the millions of actions and reactions that are required to take place from the stars and the planets all the way down to atomic and subatomic biology. God is all present at the center of the universe. Scripture tells us that not only is he the creator of heavens and earth, but he is the sustainer. He holds all things together. Finally, as we think of Genesis 1:1 and God being the creator of the heavens and the earth, we also know that God is all powerful. Only an all-powerful God could create the heaven and the earth. Only an all-powerful God could speak and bring the galaxy, stars, planets, plants, and animals into being. Hebrews 11:3 puts it this way: by faith, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was made out of things, was not made out of things that are visible. Think about that for a minute. God's very words are so powerful that he was able to speak and bring into existence everything that is. The ground that we walk on, the air that we breathe, the blood that pumps through our bodies was God's idea, his plan, his design, his creation. Every second, every minute, every hour, every day, every week, month, and year of our lives, we are able to live because God is the all-powerful and sovereign creator of everything. Part of our problem is that we have a head knowledge of this. If you've been in church any length of time, you've heard the doctrine of the omnipotence of God. You've heard the doctrine of God being the creator, God being all-knowing, all-present. And we have a head knowledge of this, but I want to ask you a question. Do we really believe, or do we really live like we really believe that God is all-powerful? Think about that for a minute. You know, Abraham struggled with this as well. In chapter 17, we're not going to go reread the verses that Terry read, but in chapter 17, God reaffirms his covenant with Abram. God changes Abram's name from Abram to Abraham. From exalted father, which is Abram, to father of a multitude, Abraham. God changed Sarah's name from Sarai to Sarai, or Sarah. Both mean princess. God reconfirms in Genesis 17 his promise that Abraham and Sarah would have a son. God even names the son Isaac, which means laughter. God also gives Abraham the symbolic act of the covenant, which is the circumcision of all males. All of this in chapter 17 hinges on verse 1. And we're going to sort of focus on the same verse we focused on last week, because I believe the omnipotence of God is something we need to think about and live our lives in relation to this. Verse 1, when Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said to him, I am God Almighty. I am omnipotent, God was saying. I am all-powerful. This means that God has the ability and the power to do whatever he wills. This is the first time in the Bible that this name, God Almighty or El Shaddai, is used. It's used 48 times in Scripture, 31 of those times in the book of Job. Job in chapter 42, verse 2, refers to God's omnipotence. Job says, I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. In other words, God can do anything and everything that lines up with his perfections. He cannot sin. He cannot lie. He cannot deny himself. He cannot change. He cannot commit iniquity. He cannot tempt or be tempted with sin. God's omnipotence doesn't mean that he does absurd or contradictory things with his power. God has also limited himself to some extent by giving free will to human beings. God could control you and me like robots or puppets, but he chooses not to. He has chosen to allow us to operate with free will and autonomy. Our response to God is based on faith, not on force. But God is all powerful. Since God is all powerful, he can do things that are beyond our comprehension. Number one, because God is all powerful, God can make impossible promises. We see several of these here in Genesis 17. I'm not going to read all the verses, but in Genesis 17, 4, God promised to make Abraham's descendants into a multitude of nations. That promise has been fulfilled, and we know that that is an impossible promise. In verse 6, God promised to make Abraham exceedingly fruitful, a 99-year-old man who had never had children. In verse 8, God promised to give Abraham the land that he was living in as an everlasting possession. Now think about that, an everlasting promise. He made that promise 3,800 years ago, and it still applies today and will continue to apply for all of eternity. By the way, if you read the news yesterday, you'll know Iran launched missiles into Israel, and they defended themselves. But only an all-powerful God can make an eternal promise. In verse 15 and 16, God promised to give Abraham and Sarah a son through Sarah. Abram and Sarah, again, were 99 and 90 years old. During their long marriage, they had never been able to have a baby. At this point, they were obviously well beyond childbearing years. But God made an impossible promise to them. God said, I will bless you with a child. We know that he fulfilled this promise and that a baby was born named Isaac. You know, there are impossible promises that God makes all through Scripture, impossible from a human standpoint. And there are hundreds, so we can't do hundreds this morning. But I've got a few. In Isaiah 7, God promised that a son would be born to a virgin. In Isaiah chapter 9, God promises that that son will be God and will rule over the world. In Isaiah 53, God promises that this son would suffer and die for our sins so that we could be forgiven and have a relationship with God. All of these impossible promises came true in Jesus Christ. God promises to give eternal life to those who believe in Jesus Christ as their Savior. John 3:36, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. See, that's an impossible promise. who can promise you life, who can promise you eternal life. But because God is all-powerful, because he is the creator of heaven and earth, he can make impossible promises. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul writes these words, which are promises that God has given us. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall all be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. Again, an impossible promise that could only be made by an all-powerful God. See, Jesus will return. Those who have died in Christ will be raised from the dead and have eternal life. Those who are alive in Christ will be raptured to meet the Lord in the skies and spend eternity with God in heaven. Again, impossible promises that only an all-powerful God could make. There's a couple more. Deuteronomy 31:8. It is the Lord who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. Do not fear or be dismayed. El Shaddai, God Almighty, promises to be with us. He promises to never leave us or forsake us. Again, promises made to us by an all-powerful God. Psalm 145:18, one of my favorite, the Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. Here's an impossible promise. God is near to every person who calls on him in truth. If there were 500 million Christians around the world praying at the same time, and they were praying from a heart that wanted to know God and love God, God knows each one of them by name. He knows their heart, their circumstance, and their prayer, and he is near them when they call on God. That's an impossible promise made by an all-powerful God. Isaiah 41:10, one of my favorite again, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. I believe every one of us can claim that promise, whether you live in the United States or anywhere in the world. Another impossible promise made by an all-powerful God. The point is, because God is all-powerful, he can make these promises and keep them. Number two, because God is all-powerful, God can produce incredible transformations. God can produce incredible transformations. Now I'm going to jump ahead and read several verses from Genesis 21. This is the passage where Isaac is born. And the promise that God had made to Abraham and Sarah 25 years before actually comes to pass. Genesis 21:1, the Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did to Sarah as he had promised. And Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age at the time of which God had spoken to him. Abraham called the name of his son who was born to him, whom Sarah bore him, Isaac. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. And Sarah said, God has made laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh over me or laugh with me. And she said, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne a son in his old age. God transformed Abraham and Sarah's bodies so that they could conceive and bear a child. God transformed Sarah's body so that she could nurse a child. God transformed a couple who were the age of great or great-great grandparents. He transformed them into parents of a newborn. All through Scripture, if there's there are a lot of themes, but a theme that we see through Scripture is that God has been producing incredible transformations in the life of people since the beginning. We've been studying Abraham now since January. God took Abraham, an idol-worshiping pagan, and transformed him into a believer of Jehovah God and a man of incredible faith. God took Moses, a fearful, tongue-tied shepherd, and turned him into the lawgiver of his chosen people and leader of millions of people. God took David, a melancholy, artistic shepherd, and transformed him into a warrior and king of his people. In the New Testament, God took fearful and self-centered disciples and transformed them into fearless preachers of the gospel message. God took Saul, a religious fanatic who was leading a persecution against Christians, and transformed him into one of the most fruitful Christians that has ever lived. The Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins and the sins of the world, was buried and was dead for 3 days. It was the power of God that resurrected him and transformed his dead body into a living body. And if you have trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior, the all-powerful God of heaven and earth has transformed you from a spiritually dead, spiritually enslaved sinner into a child of God. 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells us, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. See, because God is all-powerful, he can produce incredible transformations in your life. Are you struggling with some sin? Do you find yourself struggling with a constant bad attitude or struggling with bitterness that causes you to lash out in anger and hatred? God is an all-powerful God that can give you victory over that. He can give you a transformation. The all-powerful God of all creation, it can and will, but he's waiting for us to ask. Are you feeling defeated because you just can't get victory over certain sins in your life and you feel like you're captive to those? He's made us into a new creation. He's the all-powerful God who produces incredible transformations, and he can transform your life and give you victory over those sins, whatever they may be. Is your marriage struggling and unfulfilled? I promise you that if you will let him, God can work in your life and in your spouse's life and transform your marriage. See, our God is all powerful. And because of this, he can produce incredible transformation in our lives. Number three, because God is all powerful, he can make illogical demands. Now, stay with me on this one. I know that sounds a little out there. I want to read Genesis 17, 9 and 10 back in the chapter that we've been on. And God said to Abraham, as for you, you shall keep my covenant, you and your offspring after you throughout their generations. This is my covenant, which you shall keep between me and you and your offspring after you. Every male among you shall be circumcised. Now, we're not going to go into this passage, but this was a Jewish rite or ritual that's been practiced since this day and since the law of Moses. Most of us view believers' baptism today as a continuation of the symbolism of being set apart. But the point here is, just from a human perspective, it seems like kind of an illogical demand if we read it and think about it. But because God is all-powerful, because he is the creator of heaven and earth, he can make demands that seem, from a human perspective, illogical. In other words, from a human perspective, from a secular human standpoint, a lot of what Christians do seems illogical. But because we know that God has demanded it from us, we gladly do it. This may be a weak example, but back when I was stationed in England back in the 90s, we had a pretty vibrant church, and there was a young man that I met, and he was in our dorms, and we invited him to church, and he started coming. But the backstory was that he was from a semi-religious family. They would have called themselves Christians, but it didn't change much about how they lived. They might have went to church 5 or 6, 8 times a year. Anyway, my friend got saved at our church. He started attending our church, got baptized, and he started coming every week, even to our Saturday night Bible study. His parents became concerned about him. They thought he had joined a cult. For them, it seemed illogical that he would take God so seriously and go to church every week. And so they looked on it with worry, with concern. It seemed illogical. You know, the scripture is full of things that may seem illogical. In the story of Abraham, it was illogical for a 75-year-old man and his 65-year-old wife to leave their homeland, to travel 1,000 miles, either walking or riding a donkey, to live in another land. But Abraham did it because God is all powerful. I'm going to jump over to the New Testament. Jesus gave several commands that seem illogical to us. In Matthew 5:12, Jesus said that when people persecute us and accuse us falsely for the sake of Jesus, we should rejoice and be glad. And I don't know about you, that seems illogical. None of us want to be persecuted or talked bad about or gossiped about. Jesus said, rejoice and be glad in it when it happens because you're serving the Lord. In Matthew 5:39, Jesus said, if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other cheek also. He's commanding us here not to fight back, not to feel like we have to stoop down to get vengeance in every circumstance of our lives. If we really believe that God is all powerful, we will allow him to fight our battles. In Matthew 5:44, Jesus said, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Again, from a human perspective, these things are illogical. But because God is the all-powerful creator of heaven and earth, he can demand these things and expect for his children to obey them. In Matthew 15:24, Jesus told his disciples, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Deny ourselves? In our culture, that's the opposite of what we do. Take up our cross in order to follow Jesus, that insinuates suffering and difficulties. And yet Jesus told the disciples, if you're going to live for me, these are going to be the things that characterize your life. Again, they seem illogical from a human standpoint. But because God is all powerful, the creator of all heaven and earth, he can make these demands to us. And when we disobey him, we are disobeying him. We are in rebellion against the creator of all heaven and earth. So if we really believe, go back to our initial statement about God being the creator, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-present creator of heaven and earth. If we really believe that, the commands that we find in Scripture will not seem so illogical. You know, again, I want to go back to the beginning of the message. And if you're like me, you know the doctrines that we believe, at least the basic doctrines, and you've learned them over the years, and especially talking about God being all-powerful, all-knowing, all-present, God being the creator, God being sovereign, God being the authority. These are things that we have a head knowledge of. We may give lip service to, but we struggle to live our lives in light of these truths about God. Are you with me on that? We say we believe it, but then we go out and we live the opposite. We say we believe God is all-knowing, but then our speech, our conversations, our thoughts, our attitudes, really we deny that we believe that God is all-knowing by the way we live. We believe that God's all-powerful, and then we spend our lives wringing our hands at every little issue that comes along and sinning through doubt and through not believing what God's word tells us about God. So I want to challenge us today to ask God to help us to believe these truths about God, to believe him in such a way that it impacts our life, to believe these truths about God that it impacts us in the secret places of our heart, in the secret thoughts that we have, that our belief in the all-power, omnipotence and omnipresence of God, that it affects what we look at on our phone or on our computers. I think that we need to think about these truths about God. They're either true or false. And my question is, are you living your life in a way that reflects that you really believe these promises? Because if your life doesn't reflect that, there's a problem. There's a problem. And the problem is unbelief. We give lip service, we have head knowledge of the promises, of the doctrines, of the teachings, but then we go out and we live the opposite of what Scripture teaches. Amen. So what should we say to this? We need to ask God to help us to live in the reality of who God is. Because God is all-powerful, the three things, He can make impossible promises. Scripture's full of impossible promises. And I think it would be good for us to, I memorize verses and keep them on 3x5 cards. And when I come across a promise that talks about God, I memorize it and make it a part of my life. He can make impossible promises. Because God is all-powerful, He can make incredible transformations. He can change your life. He can give you victory over that sin that you deal with. He can give you victory over that struggle. But you've got to let Him. You've got to go to Him and ask Him and be willing to allow Him to work in your life. Because God is all-powerful, He can make illogical demands. Oh, you mean I'm not supposed to get vengeance? Oh, you mean I'm not supposed to do that? Oh, you mean I'm supposed to take up my cross and follow Jesus and deny myself? Yeah, that's what He said. And it may seem illogical from a human point of view, but if you really believe that God's all-powerful, you'll want to do that. You'll want to obey that. So I want us to think about this today. We serve an all-powerful God, creator of heaven and earth. I challenge you, go out this afternoon and just look at the sky. Listen to the birds singing. Look at the trees budding out with their fall or their spring foliage. Go out tonight. I was outside last night. The sky's beautiful. And look at the stars, the constellations. And remember, in the beginning, God created those things. With the words of His mouth, they came into being. Again, that's either true or it's false. But the most important thing is that we live and believe that, and that believing that impacts how we live. So what drives your life today? What drives the way you live, the way you think, the way you talk, your attitudes? Do you allow the circumstances around you to drive you and constantly have you in turmoil and constantly have you angry and upset about something? Do you allow the temptations, whether sexual or pornographic, to drive what you do and control what you do? Or do you allow the knowledge and the belief that God is all-powerful, all-knowing, all-present? Do you allow that belief to drive what you do and how you live? I want to challenge you, Christian. Search your heart and ask yourself before God, do I live in the real reality and belief that God is all of these attributes? Does that define my life, or does my own sin nature define my life? Because as a Christian, we're new creations in Christ Jesus. Our life should reflect the work of God in our lives. And if you're here this morning and you've never trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior, John 3:16 tells us, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The first step of belief, the first step in life to have a relationship with God is to believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior. He died on the cross. He took away our sins. He suffered the wrath of God that we all deserve. He died. He was buried. He rose again. And by trusting in Him, by resting in Him, God will forgive us, He will give us spiritual life, and He will give us eternal life. I'm going to ask David to come forward, and he's going to lead us in a song. And I just want you to consider the teachings that we've heard this morning. I hope and pray from the Word of God. And again, look in the spiritual mirror of your life and your heart and ask yourself, am I living a life that backs up the words I use when I say, I believe in God, I believe He's all-powerful, I believe He's the Creator. David?
All right, guys, let's go ahead and stand up, if you will. No.
you stand with me as we close in prayer? Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. We thank you for your love for us. As we have been reminded this morning, you are awesome, you are amazing, you are wonderful. You alone are worthy of the glory and the praise that we give and that we bring. And Lord, as we have also learned this morning, even life's most difficult circumstances are those places where we turn to you. That's because we find you in those places of difficult circumstances. So now, Lord, we pray that you'll be with us. We thank you for Jay, for Pastor Jay, for Allison, for their ministry here in this body, for the countless lives that have been touched for your kingdom. And Lord, we pray that you continue to bless them in the days ahead. Watch over them. Keep them in your care. Lord, we pray for this body as well, that it will continue to serve you, to seek your face, Lord, and to honor you, not only in this community, but around the world as you have called us to. Now, Lord, I pray that the Spirit do its work, that the devil be defeated, that he not gain victory or even a foothold, but yet your Spirit will continue to do its work in our hearts and lives, that you continue to pour that grace, that love and mercy into and through us as we try to increase your kingdom here on this world. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we thank you. Go with us now where we be salt and light as you call us to be. And it's in Christ's name we ask this. Amen.